protection without VPN without encryption, this is not responding. Let it be, because I think the console is working fine. We'll be okay to go ahead and do the practicals. We'll not be able to do anything over here. So this is our network diagram, whereas this R1 is your internal network, R5 is your internal network. Those are the remote sites, you can see it, okay? R2 is your edge device from one site, whereas R4 is another edge device for another site. Now, you want to form the VPN tunnel between two edge devices. And those will be R2 and R4. So, you'll build a VPN tunnel, because R3 is your public network. It's not your local network, okay? So, anything passing through that path or these wires should not be seen by any other guys. Even if it is being seen, it should not be interrupted, or it should not be, let's say, read by someone else. But as I explained in the first class, that VPN does not mean always the encryption, right? So today we are going to see the plain VPN. Will capture the packet as well, but if it is not responding, will not be even able to capture it. Let me knock off this and we'll come back again. So now it's working. So we'll see first the plain VPN. We'll get this two network, 10 and 192 network. Those are the two private network located, let's say one is in the Bangalore, one is in the Mumbai or somewhere else. So those two network, we'll get it communicated over the public network. So these are the two subnets which are going to be served as a public network. So first thing is, you should be having the connectivity, internal connectivity and the outside connectivity. Internal connectivity means this router, if it is an inside router, this one R1, it should have the reachability up to the R2, right? And R5 should have the reachability up to the R4. R4 and R2 are the two parties where we want to build the VPN. So these two should have the reachability. Let's check the IP address and the reachability. Let's go to R2. Let me squeeze it. Right. So let's execute the command show IP interface brief. It has the two network. This one is your private network, this one is your public network. And your other tunnel endpoint 30.1.1.4 R4. Let's check this IP address over here. This guy IP address is 20.1.1.2, which is your public IP address, okay? Let's go to R4. So IP interface brief. This guy's public IP address is 30.1.1.4. Okay. So you don't have any control over the public network, right? I mean R3 is independent, and you don't have any control. So as long as you have the reachability to your other site, you can form the VPN. Okay, other site means if you are talking at R4, you should be having the reachability to R2. So what was the IP of R2? 20.1.1.2, right? See, you have the reachability, right? Now, if you want to check the configuration of R3, you can check it. I don't have any route for the internal networks. This internet or this router, let me say the internet only. This router does not have any information about the private network, and this router will never accept any packet whose source or destination will be, or source or destination is out of the private network. Okay. So as we discussed yesterday, now we can close it actually. R3 we can close it. We don't require any configuration on it. So as we discussed yesterday, first we'll build the virtual tunnel. We'll say that it is, when you build the virtual tunnel, by default it will be JRE tunnel only. Okay, so today we'll keep it default only. In last practical, let's say SVTI, that time we'll change the mode of the tunnel. The moment you change the mode of that virtual interface, this tunnel interface, it will be treated as something else. So it's not like if you want to create the JRE tunnel, so you have to create another type of tunnel interface and the commands are different. It's not like this one. The defining the virtual interface, the syntax remains the same only. What you define under or beneath it will change the behavior of this tunnel interface. So let's say on R2, interface tunnel. The name is number I am giving is 1. Let's assign the IP address. Do we have the information about the IP address? What IP address are we going to take when we want to build the VPN tunnel? Sorry, GRE tunnel between these two net. Yesterday I had given some explanation and the elements as well, right? What are the things it should have? What was that? The GRE tunnel or tunnel interface? Let me go to R2. Yeah. See, virtual interface is, you create interface tunnel 1, it is called the virtual interface. Okay, what was that?
Source.
What are the things you had to define?
IP address. Okay.
So here we did not consider the IP address. We did not plan out the IP address. Let's say we are going to take the IP addresses. So 172.16.0.0/24. So these three octets remains the same. One side we will assign one IP address, one side we will assign another IP address. So let's go to R2 and give the IP address 172.16.0.2, because last octet I am taking is the router number. So you have assigned the IP address to the tunnel interface. Now what was the another thing?
Source.
Tunnel source FA0/0, because my tunnel will be on FA0/0, right? It will be exiting out, or it will be physical interface is FA0/0 where I want to terminate or start the tunnel. Now what was the another thing? Tunnel destination. Who is the other guy where you want to terminate this tunnel? So that will be your 30.1.1. What is the IP address of your R4? 4, right? So run interface tunnel 1. So that's all you require so far. So the similar thing you have to configure at R4. Okay. Let's go to R4. Define the parameters, create the interface and define the parameters. Config T, interface tunnel 1, and it does not require to have the same number. Let's say I am creating interface tunnel 10. Though I have the interface tunnel 1, but I am not going to configure anything onto it. So IP interface brief will show you that how many tunnel interface do you have. Okay. So let's say I am going to tunnel interface 10 only. What should be the IP address over here? 172.16.0. These three must be there, dot something, right? So we'll just take the last octet as a router number. Tunnel source is what? Tunnel source. You can define the interface or you can define the IP address. It is flexible, it is not required. But tunnel destination, you cannot define the interface. You have to define the IP address. Now you ping to the other end of this IP address. 172.16.16.0. So this tunnel has been built already. Okay. Now let's see. This GRE tunnel is built. You cannot check like so crypto ISEC MPSA or IPSEC SA or so GRE or something. This is the tunnel interface you created, and that tunnel interface is giving you the way, because of the GRE, it is giving you the way of creating the private virtual private network. Let's say I am capturing this packet on internet line. And let's see what are the things it is adding and what can internet guy see? Let's say again I am pinging, okay? Now you refresh it. What is the tunnel source and destination? Let's say if I double click, yes. This is the one packet I have kept you. Okay. So out of all these packets, I am exploring to one packet. Layer 2 information. Okay. Layer 3 information. What is the source and destination? What is inside it? What is the GRE IP address and all? So you are into the packet, you are looking into the payload actually. This is after the right after this one, all you are seeing in beneath it, it is payload. Okay. Right after this one, whatever you are seeing is the payload. When we do the IPsec, that time we will check what is the information we are seeing over here, and after this one we will only be able to see ESP, that's it. Okay. So under this one, under ESP, you will not see anything else. So now you are actually able to see everything. That GRE header is added. Original IP address also you are seeing. What was the payload also you are seeing. What type of protocol is being encapsulated under the GRE. So see, ICMP you seen, GRE also you seen, and IP. So this is plain. You are seeing, you are exploring, and you are actually going inside the packet and you are able to see. Okay. Let's say, and for your testing purpose, if you want to see from the same topology, okay, from the same topology, you enable telnet on R2 and telnet from R4, again capture the packet, explore those packets. In the telnet data, you will see clear text. Whatever the show IP interface brief or show running or whatever the running configuration is fetched up, every single thing will be seen on the packet capture. But you have to see different packet. It's not, it will not be on the one packet only. It will not be one packet, but you have to explore 3 or 4 or 5 packets and you will come to know that. Okay, so I showed you the way, now you have to explore it. Now, we did not actually achieve reach to our goal. That our goal was what? We wanted to communicate 10.1.1.0 to 192.168.1.0 network, right? Okay. Let's go to R1. This is your source, right? So whenever you want to have any communication, if you are a source, first start from the source and send your packet to the destination. If your packet is reaching to the destination, still you are not getting the reply. If you are 100% sure that your packet is reached to the destination, go over there, get the confirmation. Once you are done with that, now track back the following path or return path. So packet communication is not only one way, it is two way. If you want to get this reply, ping and then exclamation mark, you have to say that, you have to consider that actually two paths are clear, not only one path, transmission and receiving path. Now over here, R1. I want to reach to the 192.168. When I ping 192.168.1.5, I should be able to get the reply, because this is the private network of my branch, which is in the Mumbai, right? If I type over here, I will not get the reply. So how do you start first? First you should check the routing, because router will first check the inbound ACL. Since it is locally generated, so inbound ACL, session lookup, all the steps are out, all these steps are already skipped. Now the first thing I'll start with the route lookup. Do I have the routing information first? Then only the other things, whether VPN is there or any other thing. First it will check the routing table if it is locally generated. So since we are pinging from R1, so it will, the first step will be the routing lookup, right? Do you have any information about 192.168 network? No, right? Let's say I want to define the route. IP route 192.168.1.0. Now what will be my next hop address? That is the big question, right? Sorry? Do you have any reachability to tunnel IP? you can only define the next hop address from this network, right? Or you can only define the next hop address if you have the reachability to that IP address. Let's say I want to define the next hop address as this one. Do I have the reachability to 30.1.1.4? It's not possible. It's like, it's not logical thing to define the, whenever you are defining any route, make sure that you are able to reach your next hop address first. If you are unable to reach this one, you will never be able to reach this network. Alright. So here, what should be your next hop address? 10.1.1.2, right? Okay. So this guy is done with the routing. Inside router has done with the routing. Now let's go to R2. R2 has received the packet. Destination is 192.168.1.5. Right? Do you have any reachability to 192.168.1.0 network? No. This is your internet edge router. Now, what should be your next hop address? If you give the next hop address as your internet router, it will drop the packet. Why? Because source or destination, any of this packet, any of this field is coming from the private IP address. It is violating the internet rule. Right? So where should you send this packet? So now that's where you will define that your next hop address should be your tunnel interface. Okay. So now it will hit the tunnel interface. The moment it hits the tunnel interface, all the procedures start what I explained yesterday. It will add the GRE. Once it is done encapsulated, it will say that who is my source, again add the IP address and send it to the destination of the tunnel. Once it is reached over destination, decapsulated, GRE is also decapsulated. Now that will be the original packet. Let's say we will again discuss about it. First define the route for 192.168.1.0. That's how you define the route. Or you can define the IP as well. 172.16.0.2. But the best way is to define the tunnel. Now let's say, again I am from R1. Now your packet is ready or your routing issue has been solved from R1 to the R5. Okay, let me show you this. Go to R5, debug IP ICMP. Okay, go to R1. This is your private network, right? R5 was also your private network. Let's ping 192.168.1. Go to R5. Packet is reached to the destination. Okay. Now, what is the insight into it? Packet dispatched from over here. Source was 10.1.1.1. Destination is 192.168.1.5. Reached over here. Why reached over here? Because you defined the route. So it reached over here. You said over here, if you have any packet 192.168.1.0 network, you send it to the tunnel interface 1. So it sent to the tunnel interface 1. Tunnel interface says that I am GRE. Add the GRE header into it. It has added the original packet, has been added with the GRE encapsulation. Now, the source and destination IP address will be the tunnel source and tunnel destination, the original one. Okay, the original one is actually again encapsulated with the GRE IP header. So, the communication is between this tunnel actually. Original communication, if someone is capturing over here, you will see the IP address is this public IP address. It reached over here. Since it was the destined to him, tunnel is terminating over here, so it will decapsulate it. If tunnel is not terminated over here, simply it will discard it. Okay, so it will decapsulate it. It will see that tunnel interface is also my local interface. So again, it will decapsulate and remove the GRE inside the original packet or inside the GRE. Once the GRE decapsulation has been happened inside it, it is found that the destination is 192.168.1.5, and that is my local. So it is sent to the R5. Now R5 doesn't know about 10.1.1.0 network to reply back. See, what is the original content? Source is 10.1.1.1, destination is 192.168.1.5. you are seeing the message over here is echo reply. Okay, if you debug IP packet, you will see the original IP address received. Once it is received, process and he is trying to send it. But this routing table of this guy does not have the reachability to 10.1.1.0 network. So let's define the route. IP route 10.1.1.0. Where will you send it?
Sir, next one.
192.168.1.4, right? So this guy is done with it. Go to R4. Are we done with the routing or still we have to define anywhere else? We have to define on R4. IP route 10.1.1.0. 255.255.255.0. I am sending to the tunnel 10, not tunnel 1. I have tunnel 1, but it is not configured. So just to show you that we did not have any problem in the tunnel interface naming or numbering. Alright. Now, if R1 or R5, let's test it from this side. 10.1.1.1, right? Got it? Two private networks are communicating. Did we discuss anything about ICKM, IPsec or anything else? No, right? So that is a plain VPN. Now if you want to capture the packet or if you want to see on it, you can see it. The packet will look like this one only. If you open it, what is the original IP? This one, right? Inside it, it is also showing what is the original packet and GRE header it is added and all, right? So internet guy can see GRE is not actually giving you the protection. So inside of any packet, internet guy can see it, but still you don't have any problem of routing. Why? Because you are adding one more header or original IP header because of this GRE tunnel. Now let's add the security into it. So the GRE VPN is over and this is called the plain VPN. So is it a VPN or not? According to our definition, whatever we have learned, right? Are we communicating to private network? Are we adding any security into it? Is it protected? Still we have the communication, right? So that's a plain VPN. Now, as we know that nobody is going to implement like this one. Always it will be. So this GRE communication has been done. Plain VPN has been done. Now let's add in protection into it. What was the protection? What we had discussed so far? IPsec. In order to have the IPsec communication, what should be negotiated first? Key must be negotiated first. How you can negotiate the key? By using which protocol? IKU or ICKM, right? So now, as you know that, as we have done one practical of site-to-site configuration, policy must be same at both the side, right? Okay. So now, most of our communication or most of our configuration will be where? R2 and R4. Okay, testing PCR, R1 and R5. But if your PC does not support these many routers, you can take only 3 and you can do the practical. I did with the 3 only, but since it is supporting more and does not have any problem, so just making it very clear. Let's go to R1. Or else, we'll do one thing. We'll write the policy over here. And we'll paste the same policy at both the sides, so we'll not make any problem. But I don't have any problem in remembering or troubleshooting any VPN, but I'll write over a console only. But when you do the practice, if you are not good at the remembering or if you are not so solid at each and every component, make this thing, open the notepad and write down the same policy, IPsec, ICKM policy and IPsec transform that. So you will not be confused that what 3 days I have used over there or pressure I have used or here what I am using and all. Okay. Crypto ISACAM policy, any number. But in the production network, it depends which number you assign. The lower the number, it will search. The search of the ISACAM policy will be first. Okay. So encryption I am going to use DES. Authentication I am going to use preset. Hash I am going to use MD5. Group I am going to use 1. So crypto ISACAM policy will display the number of policy you have configured. Okay. Now if you execute this command, so run pipe section crypto, as of now it will show only crypto ISACAM policy, right? But see here, there is no encryption, there is no group. Why? Because those are the default values. So what is the default value of crypto ISACAM? Is this one. See here. Sorry. This is the default. Default ISACAM values. Default ISACAM policy. So if the question is what is the default ISACAM policy in iOS, your answer should be DES is the encryption, SHA as your hash, RSA signature should be encryption, and group 1 is your DFLMAN. Okay. So whatever the value you are overriding, that will be displayed on the running configuration. All of this default value will not be displayed. Okay. Now let's define the IPsec suite. So crypto IPsec transforms it. Let's say the name. I am giving any name. Any name you can give. It's not like, you know, the protocol or something. Any name you can give. GRE. I am going to use ESP in 3 days. ESP and SHA. Okay. So these two value, crypto ISACAM policy and this IPsec transform set, these two must be same at both the side. Make sure that. Okay. So let's get it done with the other side as well. Config T crypto ISACAM policy 100. You can define anything. Because we don't have, you know, 100 policy or anything. If one policy is found, it's not there. Okay, directly the second search will be 100 one. But if you have 100 to 99 policies, make sure that you, if you want this policy to be searched first, you have to adjust with the numbers. Encryption DES, authentication preset, group 1, SMD5. Crypto IPsec, transform set, GRE over IPsec. I can write anything, it's not again, it should not be same at both the side. ESP, DES, ESP, what was the value we had taken? SHA, right? Actually we had taken 3 days. Sorry?
What is the default value over there in IPsec? Like we have default value over there in ISO?
No, we don't have any.
But in hash you used MD5?
Yeah.
In IPsec, we can use
that is two different thing. There is no relativity between these two. IPsec and ISACAM, there is no relativity, right? Yes or no?
Yes.
We had understood it, right? When the ISACAM first, when first parameter or phase one has to be negotiated for the key exchange, what cipher suite you are using? That is our ISACAM. Okay. Once the negotiation has been done, key has been exchanged. Then what is to be used for the data encryption and decryption? That is this IPsec. ISACAM one is what is to be used for the key exchange. So once the key exchange has been done, that is out of the picture. We have something which will be used for this protocol and this encryption algorithm.
And if question is not given, then what
you can use anything. If it is not, these values are not given, you can use anything. There is no restrictions. Alright. So what were we talking? Yeah, transform set and ISACAM policies, right? So we have configured. So crypto ISACAM policy. So crypto IPsec transform set. Right? Are we missing in phase 1 and phase 2 anything? Exactly right. Phase 1 is not completed. We have to have the key defined. because we said that we are going to use pre-seed as a authentication, but we did not define the key for both the end. So let's define it. Crypto ISAKM key is Cisco 123. Again, if this value is not given, you can take anything. If otherwise, those values will be already given into the question. Or in the real time scenario, you'll probably be given a draft, complete document, that what should be your cipher suite, what should be your MD5, what should be your hashing, what should be the way of communication, which protocol should be the used, and what is the key, what is the authentication method, if it is a certificate, who is the provider, which way you use to enroll the certificate. All the information will be given to you. So address, what address should I type over here? Is it a tunnel interface IP address or your physical IP address? Physical IP address or tunnel IP address? You are building the tunnel between two physical IP address. Inside it you are using something. Yes, inside it you are doing something. Right? The reachability or the tunnel endpoint or publicly known to host are public IP address. So what is the IP address? 20.1.1.2 Crypto ISAKM key. What is the IP address of this one? 30.1.1.4, right? Okay. Phase 1 is completed. Phase 2, raw material is completed. Phase 1 is completely completed. Phase 2 is raw material completed. When you want to protect this tunnel, GRE tunnel, you don't have to create the ACL. Why? The GRE tunnel is already created. Now you are going to say that apply this IPsec suite into the tunnel. So whatever is passing through that tunnel will be subjected to the protection. You don't have to create the crypto map or ACL or anything. What you have to create is crypto IPsec profile. Yesterday we discussed, right? So crypto IPsec profile, let's say GRE is the name of this one. Set, transform set. What was the name? Do so crypto IPsec transform set. Set transform set GRE. So what just now we had created? We have created IPsec profile. So far what we have created? ISAKM policy, IPsec transform set, and a profile under which we have specified the transform set. Why do we need this profile? Because we cannot directly apply the transform set under the interface. In the site-to-site configuration, crypto map was there, which is the element you can apply directly onto the interface. And crypto map is something where you can relate the transform set. But now crypto map, we are not going to use it. What we are going to use is profile, and directly we are going to apply that profile under the virtual tunnel interface. In other words, tunnel interface. So the final piece is, go to the tunnel interface one. Now how to apply it? Tunnel protection IPsec profile. What was the name of this profile? Just now we had created GRE, right? That's it. Now if you try to ping, it will build up the IPsec ISAKM tunnel, but it will not allow you to ping. Why? Because that side you did not configure the tunnel protection, right? Let's check it. Ping before this one on R2. So crypto ISAKM PSA. Do you have any ISAKM? Do you have any tunnel up? No, right? Let's say ping 192.168.1.5. You will not get the reply, that is for sure. But just check that. Do you have the phase 1 up? What was the endpoint? R4, right? Yeah. Why it is not taking anything? See here. So crypto ISAKM PSA. There is not a process. The process is not even started. Why? Because he is not listening. The moment you apply it under the tunnel interface, any IPsec profile, anything, you will get the message that ISAKM is on. Right? It is not on. So on R4, I think we have created the transform set and all, right? So crypto IPsec transform set. So crypto IPsec MP. So crypto IPsec MPC. Okay. Create the IPsec profile. Set transform set. GRE over IPsec. I think that is the that was the name.
Yeah.
GRE over IPsec. Okay. Now go to the interface tunnel 10. Tunnel protection. IPsec profile. GRE, right? See. Right? Now if you go and ping, you got the reply, right? Now again we will capture the packet and we will see that what exactly we are able to see. Tunnel is up. Okay. Now let's stop it. Oh, we did a mistake actually. We did not have to stop it. We could have captured the packet over here. So we could have compared it. Anyway, but you still remember, right? What point I have shown you in the previous capture. Let's go to R1, again do the ping, refresh it. Are you able to see exactly what is being traveled under the ESP? So that is the protection. Now nobody can see what is being traveled under the ESP. So what practical we have done so far? GRE over IPsec, VPN just now we have finished, right? Now, inside the ESP, what is being traveled? It is actually original packet plus 26 byte, right? So Cisco came up with the something and it is giving you all the functionality and he is saying that I will give you the feature which will not add your 26 byte onto the original communication. And that concept is called what? SVTA. So the configuration of SVTI is like 2 seconds. How you configure the SVTA is on R2, go to the interface tunnel, okay, tunnel mode IPsec IP version 4, and which will make your tunnel not GRE, SVTI. Now this is Cisco proprietary tunnel. Okay. Now GRE is not there, but I cannot verify actually into it because already the packet is already encapsulated into the ESP. And this feature SVTI is only supported if you have or if you want to build the tunnel that is with the IPsec. Plain SVTI is not there.
GRE
is out of the picture. The moment you are executing this command, it is now not, it is not adding any GRE into it. It is the tunnel interface without GRE. We discussed yesterday, right? What was the purpose of this SVTI? Because GRE is adding the 26 byte onto the original packet. So it says that it is not actually good. See, the tunnel is down. Because that side we did not say it. Let's go and configure this one. Yes, yes. Purpose of SVTI is, first of all, the purpose of first of all, the purpose of GRE was to encrypt the multicast traffic, right? Still, we did not test it. As of now, we did not test it. We'll run two routing protocol now and we'll get that our main goal also been tested. So, plain IPsec or site-to-site IPsec is not giving you the multicast encryption. It is not encrypting the multicast traffic. So, GRE came into the picture, but GRE is plain text. So you took the GRE based feature, you took the IPsec based feature and you combined all. So now multicast is also being encrypted and secure. Okay, two site to site is working fine. But the problem over here was GR is adding the 26 byte on every packet because it is adding some other protocol encapsulation. So to overcome this one, Cisco has developed one more solution, and that is called SVTI, where it is providing all the services what GRE was providing, multicasting, a complete tunnel interface where you can apply the QoS and all every single thing without adding the GRE adder. So you are overcoming of 26 byte of adder. So that burden is knocked off. So SVTI is the multicast enable interface or IPsec interface. It is not plain text. GRE is just the plain. But in GRE with IPsec, if you don't want to have the IPsec, the only option for you is to GRE. There is no any something which cannot add the header and will give you the multicasting feature. Okay. Right. So now the final piece of the testing is our main goal was to have the multicasting exchange between these two. Now, let's say this site, this branch is using. This branch uses the, let's say, okay, OSPF, done, OSPF area 0, okay. This guy is also using OSPF. I'll keep it simple only, but you can have like EAGRP over here, OSPF over here, still you can do the communication, still you can exchange the routes, but I'll keep it simple.
Redistribute,
it's obvious. There is no any concept which can, you know, intelligently learn. No, you have to do it. Alright. So, let's say go to R1 and R2 and enable the OSPF. Okay. R1, config T, router OSPF. Network 10.1.1.0, right? So IP protocol, I have enabled the 10.1.1. I have enabled OSPF on router 1, which is your internal router, and I am communicating or I am advertising 10.1.1.1. As of now, if you see neighbor relationship, there is no anyone who is participating into the OSPF process. Now let's enable the OSPF onto the neighbor R2, router OSPF 1, network 10.1.1.0. okay, now so IP OSPF neighbor, you have the neighbor. Now if anyone is advertising one more network, he'll get that network information, right? Yes or no?
Yes.
Okay. Now simple thing. Now let's enable the OSPF over here as well. Okay. There is no any communication as of now. As of now, there is no any communication for or multicasting communication between R2 to R4, between two branches. There is no any multicasting communication as of now. We are just setting up the internal routing protocol, okay, for our internal network, one network and another network. Go to R4, exit, router OSPF, let's say 10, network 192.168.1.0, area 0, exit. Go to router 5, do the same thing. Now you should be having the OSPF neighborship, right? Have we advertised the same network? 0.0.0.255, right? On R4, 0.0.0.255. What is the problem? Otherwise, if it is not coming, just give the assign the router ID. Okay, sometime when you have few networks in the network, it will take the highest IP address as the router ID, right?
Yes.
In order to skip that process, just assign the manual IP address, so the selection will be just like that. Now you see, you have the neighborship with the router 4. Okay, now how many interface do you have on R2? Let's talk about R2. How many interface do you have, and on how many interface you have enabled the OSPF? You have 3 interface, you have enabled the OSPF on 1. Okay, FA0/1 is communicating with your internal network, FA0/0 is communicating your outside network where you don't enable the OSPF, or you might be running BGP or something else, or another BGP OSPF process, sorry, you can have it. There is another interface, tunnel interface, which is directly connected to R4, which is not connected to R3, but which is directly connected to R4. Okay. Now, if you enable the OSPF into it, and you enable the OSPF on R4, are they communicator? Are they, or can they be a neighbor? If your tunnel, whatever tunnel you have created, if that tunnel is not able to transmit the multicast, they will never become a partner, they will never become the neighbor, right? If we can see the result as a neighbor, so can we say that the statement the tunnel created is transmitting the multicast traffic? Can we make sure that once, let's say, on interface tunnel 1 and on interface tunnel 10, I want to enable the OSPF. I'll advertise 172.16.0.0/24 network into the same OSPF process. And now, if R4 is getting R2 as a neighbor, so can I say that this tunnel is transmitting multicast traffic?
Yes. Yes.
Right? Okay. Let's see. R4 network 172.16.0.0. Okay. Go to your R2 router OSPF. What is the process number? 1, right? Yeah. Network 70.16.0.0.255. See, let's check the neighborship. Who is your neighbor? Right? It has taken the highest IP address, that's why it is not the this one. Right? What is the physical address? Actually, it's a tunnel end to end. The OSPF is enabled on the tunnel, not the physical. Physical IP will never be seen. So, again, if you capture the packet over here, you will never be seen anything. Whatever the picture you have captured previously, you will see the same behavior, same kind of the visualization of the packet, nothing else. Alright. So now this tunnel is, can we say that this tunnel is a multicast enabled tunnel? Right? Now let's go to R5 and see the routing updates. Do you have the routing updates? See, this network is being learned. Right? It should also see 10.1.1. network, right? Why it is not showing? Static route we have defined. We have defined the static route, that's why it will not take the OSPF is already sending one route, 10.1.1. From where? From your R1. Okay. But it will not be into the routing table. Why? Because you have defined the static route. No IP route 10.1.0.255.255.255.0.192.168.1.4. Go to R1 and do the same thing for 192 network, right? Because here you will not see the 192 network as a OSPF network or OSPF route, but rather you will see it as a static. No IP route 192.168.1.0. Got it? So you are exchanging the routing information over the VPN. So now this final practical is GRE over IPsec, SVTA, every single thing, whatever we have discussed last time, yesterday, it's been done. So, that's all this three thing, plain VPN, GRE over IPsec, or the plain VPN, and then you add the protection. Once the protection is added on the GRE tunnel, then you remove that 26 byte overhead of the external header. Alright.